Hello, my group consists of me, Ekaterina Gavenko, Arina Veselova, and Safiya Maroz, and we are going to talk about in-betweenness and hybrid identities in the West.
Speaking about the term identity, according to the Wikipedia encyclopedia, identity is the qualities, beliefs, personality, looks, or expressions that make a person or a group. Hybridity or hybrid identity is a cross between two separate races, plants, or cultures. A hybrid is something that is mixed, and hybridity is simply a mixture. The term hybridity is not a modern one. It was common among the Greeks and Romans. In Latin, hybrida or hybrida refers to the offspring of a tame sow and a wild boar. So the Greeks and Romans borrowed this term from the Egyptians and Persians in particular. The word hybridity was in use in English since the early 17th century and gained popular currency in the 19th century. Charles Darwin used these terms in 1837 in the reference to his experiments in cross-fertilization in plants. The concept of hybridity was always perceived negatively. Aristotle, Plato, and Pericles were all opposed to racial mixing between Greeks and barbarians and viewed biological hybridity as a source of racial degeneration and social disorder. The Roman Empire, which was considered one of the multi-ethnic empires, cultural differences there was usually integrated into the predominant culture, whereas biological hybridity was condemned. The Romans' attitudes to racial mixing hardened from the 4th century before Christ, when Rome embraced the Christian faith. According to the Codex of Theodosianus, the marriages between Christians and non-Christians were prohibited, and those who did not obey the law were inflicted on death penalty. Contempt for biological hybridity did not end with the fall of Roman Empire and dwelt into there in modern times, reaching its peak in the 19th century with the rise of Europe into an unrivaled imperial power. At the end of 18th century, the term hybridity was forming a fearful discourse of a racial mixing. Pseudoscientific models of anatomy and craniometry were used to argue that Africans, Asians, Native Americans, and Pacific Islanders were racially inferior to Europeans. Hybridity and fear of racial degeneration caused by mixing of Europeans and non-Europeans, and these were the major concern in 19th century. These topics were raised in the works of Joseph Arthur de Gobineau in his work Essay on Race Inequality and Joseph Ernest Renan's in his work Cultural and Moral Education. The fear of miscegenation that followed responds to the concern that the offspring of racial interbreeding would result into the dilution of the European race. Hybrids were seen as an aberration, worse than the inferior races, a weak and diseased mutation. Hybridity as a concern for racial purity responds clearly to the digest of colonialism, where despite the backdrop of the humanitarian age of enlightenment, social hierarchy was beyond contention as what the position of Europeans at the end as its summits. The development of hybridity theory as a discourse of anti-essentialism marked the height of the popularity of academic hybridity talk. Hybrid talk, the rhetoric of hybridity, is fundamentally associated with the emergence of post-colonial discourse and its critics of cultural imperialism. It is the second stage in the history of hybridity, characterized by literature and theory that study the effects of mixture, hybridity, upon identity and culture. The principal theorists of hybridity are Omi Pabba, Nestor Garcia Canclini, Stuart Holt, Gayatri Spivak, and Paul Gilroy, whose works respond to the multicultural awareness that emerged in the early 1990s.
Every theorist has different attitude to the hybridity. Robert Young traced the origins of the term back to the early 17th century. Derived from Latin, it was seldom found until the 19th century, but in biological or botanical descriptions. It first recorded use in the 19th century to denote the crossing of people of different races and is given in the Oxford Dictionary in 1861. But Young points out that it has also been previously used in the context of race mixture, and especially in relation to human fertility. He also relates the definition found in the Oxford Dictionary to other previously used terms like mixed or intermediate races. The significant point in Young's account of the increasing use of the terms hybrid and hybridity in the 19th century is that it marks the rise of the belief that there could be such a thing as a human hybrid.
The key text in the theoretic development of hybridity is The Location of Culture, written in 1994 by Omi Bhabha, where the liminality of hybridity is presented as a paradigm of colonial anxiety. Hybridity demonstrates how cultures come to be represented by a process of iteration and translation through which their meanings are vicariously addressed to through and another. Symphony is another very important element of hybridity identity. It was introduced by Mikhail Bakhtin and presented in Folklore and Anthropology. According to Bakhtin's concept of polyphonic dialogism, which rests primarily on human philosophy, according to which human life itself, its consciousness, and relations with others have a dialogical nature. According to Bakhtin, every human has its the interhuman, intersubjective, and interindividual. Two human beings make up a life and a being, and Bakhtin considers a person as a unique individuality and personality.
Jean Peter says that hybridity is to culture what deconstruction is to discourse, transcending binary categories. Dubois describes hybridity as resulting in a double consciousness. It explicitly embodies multiple identities which exist in one person, a kind of two-ness. Gilroy expands Dubois' idea, saying that navigating between two cultural groups can be a hindrance, whereas Blau and Brown describes two-ness as a whale individuality who has a second sight and is able to see others better than they can be seen, as well as seeing yourself in the view of others. Referring to hybridity in politics, Roberta Lavata in 2004 pinpoints a backlash in white minority politics. Although they represent only 47% of California's population, Anglos are still more than 70% of the registered electorate. A series of state ballot initiatives has sought to deny public education to children of the undocumented and has attacked affirmative action and bilingual education programs. Other United States states along the border have witnessed the formation of so-called Minutemen groups comprised of private citizens who volunteer their services to support the efforts of the United States Border Patrol. They have also begun to mimic the initiative process pioneered in California, producing their own anti-immigrant measures under such rubrics as A Safe Arizona Now.
Languages are all hybrid in varying degrees. For centuries, people borrowed from foreign languages, creating thus hybrid linguistic idioms. The Greeks soaked many mathematical and astronomical concepts from the Egyptians, and the Romans absorbed much of Greek culture and ideas. The French language, for example, contains over 200 Arabic and Berber words, most of which were taken during the French colonization in Algeria. Similarly, hundreds of Indian words entered the English idiom from 17th to 19th century. According to the Oxford Dictionary, more than 900 words are of Indian origin. The most revealing example of hybridity is the rise of Spanglish. This is a mongrel language between Spanish and English. Nowadays, it is used to have fun, for pleasure, but the real reason was, of course, to communicate. English speakers arrived at the border, takes the rise of Spanglish, Ellen Stevens, professor of Spanish at Amherst College. He believes that someday Spanglish will become a full-fledged language and will replace Spanish.
And after the theoretical part, I would really like to touch on the subject of the American ideology of the melting pot that was especially popular in the 20th century. The definition of a melting pot in the Cambridge English Dictionary says that a melting pot is a place where many different people and ideas exist together, often mixing and producing something new. It is true, that is basically the ideology and the sense and the force that would drive in people in order to come up with this ideology, to unite. Firstly, the term appeared in 1780s because it was the first time when immigrants had started to come to the United States of America in big groups of people, so the flow of immigrants was noticeable, and people even then have started thinking about melting of the culture together. And it wasn't even about the immigrants, because even the natives in the America at this time, because America, of course, it's a country of immigrants, and the whole idea of being united as a whole, as a country, without being diversified by your cultural background, it was there all the time. But the first concept of something similar to the melting pot was originated in the 1780s. And then the actual phrase, the actual term melting pot had appeared at the same year when the so-called play, the theatrical play, was first staged and written in 1908. And the play was called The Melting Pot, and it held the same idea as its name. So basically the gist was about the different cultures and the mix of different cultures. The two of the biggest consequences that led from the fall of the melting pot ideology and why it wasn't successful is that despite even the try of stepping away from racism, still non-white people, especially Asian Americans, are being asked, but where are you really from? So you could be born, your grandfather, your great-grandfather could be born in the United States of America, but still people would be asking you, but where are you really from? Because of your looks, because they just didn't believe that you were American, and because they just didn't see you as a part of their culture. And that's how the non-white society had greatly suffered after the melting pot ideology, because they have embraced and they have welcomed all the immigrants, but they didn't think of the fact that a lot of people, the general public, who didn't have their mind broad enough to accept this as a fact, they were against it, and that's why they held their biases against the non-white community. And that's why people who didn't have fair skin and fair hair got asked really, really frequently, but where are you really from? And not only that, also while one of the biggest parts of the ideology of the melting pot was the idea of mixing cultures together, it became evident that it's not all that good and great, and that mixing cultures together can be really, really harmful for the representatives and for the cultures themselves. Because the idea of mixing cultures together was basically introducing exotic cultures to the white people. So that's why white people can go to Japanese or Chinese restaurants or try Indian food and something like that. But the Japanese or Indian or Chinese food is not the culture, it's not the people. But whenever a white American person things about those people. They just think about their food. And that's not it, because the non-white culture, any culture, is so much more than everything that has been introduced and liked by the white society. Because it's really the choice that the people made while accepting the culture. So they just cut out those parts that they didn't like, and they have left the food that they liked, forgetting about everything else and forgetting about the fact that by using others' culture, or by not paying enough respect to others' culture, people are being really, really rude to the people who have this culture within them. And that's one of the harmful ways, because the white population, they have objectified other cultures that have been introduced to them, and they have narrowed them towards the small parts and the small things that have been changed and adapted to the white culture. And they associate that with cultures, which is wrong and which is really harmful, and which kind of creates the idea, the wrong idea about the cultures. And the second part is that actually the white population also had greatly suffered, because the white society isn't just one race, it isn't just white culture. In the white part of the population, there are a lot of different nationalities and cultures as well, but they are not being seen as such. There is just white and non-white, and the white population, their also their culture, their ideology, their beliefs have been washed off, and they are perceived as a enemy of the colorful, if I dare say that, and they're being mocked, because there are many, many stereotypes about the white people, who also are not really that white, because a lot of people who have fair skin are actually Asian, but because of their skin color, they're still being treated like the white majority, and they're being looked down on because of the things that other people who are against different cultures have said or expressed. Instead of tracing the dead-end jobs that are available to them due to inadequate housing and the recently restructured labor markets, the migrants discharge their anger and frustrations against their co-national within the migrant community. This is a citation from Michael Kearney, University of California, from his Post-Melting Pot Realism, which was a review of two books on that matter. And what he's talking about is the fact that the people, the immigrants who had decided to travel and who had decided to move to the United States, they do not get the same support from the community of people who share their background, because it's a different country, and because the whole country, the white population, the majority of the country, they became so scared of immigrants invading their territory that they had formed a really, really negative attitude towards them, to the point where when a group of immigrants have lived in the country for 5 years and they meet another group of immigrants who had just arrived in the country, the more experienced group of immigrants would have the same negative stigma, and they would think that the new immigrants shouldn't have came here, the new immigrants don't have a right to be here, even though they have been in the same position just 5 years ago. And the fall of the melting pot ideology, like how it happened and what had happened, what it had cost, it's really ugly, and it had became a fuel for the rivalry even between the people who had shared their culture and their identity. And the people who are against the new immigrants, they are conflicted just like any other person, because first of all, they still want to live with that the cultural heritage that they came with, because it's their culture, it's their life, it's who they are, and they obviously don't want to just give it up, and they cannot give it up. You cannot just live for 40 years with one set of beliefs and then change to another one in just a mere second. That doesn't happen. But at the same time, the society, the American society, who had developed a strong dislike towards the immigrant community, towards the non-white community, they're telling you that you need to be more Western, that you need to give up your beliefs that the white population doesn't like. And they are in between of complying to the standards and to the requirements that the society, the American society, had put in them. And between the fact that they don't want to lose their identity and they are stuck in between, not knowing where to go and what to do, because the white society doesn't see them as their own because they're of different color, they're of different faith, they are of different culture, and the immigrant society doesn't see them as their own as well because they have been westernized, because they have shifted from the whole spectrum of the traditions, because they had to give something up, and they are being left behind by the both societies, and they suffer from it greatly. All in all, hybrid identities have a strong connection to multiculturalism because they share the same roots. The hybrid identities are the byproduct of the idea of embracing multiculturalism, but there are so many bad implications of the melting pot ideology, of the fall of the melting pot ideology that hasn't been successful, that it shows that perhaps it's not a good idea to try and mix everyone together. Because hybrid identities, the people who bear hybrid identities, they're now stuck in between. They have no place to go and they do not fit into the normal society, into the society of the white people, or into the society of people who share their cultural background, because they are a mix and both sides do not want to deal with mixes. And also, a lot of rich cultures, and African, Indian, Asian, it doesn't matter, they have been washed out and they have been modified to the liking of the general public, and they have lost their cultural identity, they have lost their rich heritage in the land of the United States of America, which also always really, really sad when the society acts in a way that makes you lose the traditions that you have been bearing and that the generations of your family before you have been bearing and have been saving because they wanted those traditions to live. But right now, all it's left is just food and some national costumes that people tend to wear on Halloween. And there are also a lot of stereotypes and generalization towards both white and non-white community, which had resulted in this kind of toxic relationship between them, and especially it is evident in the social media right now. And it doesn't matter if the exchange is between the older generations or the younger generations, they still use the same stigmas, they still use the same stereotypes, and also nearly always in a bad way. Well, as I've said, immigrants are struggling to find the group of people who would accept them, the newly came immigrants, the people who had just arrived in the country, because they're not welcome even by their own people. And the fall of this ideology had also resulted in the fear of immigrants as a whole, because the American society had started to perceive immigrants also as a big cluster, just like all of the people perceive white people as a big cluster of people. And if they had some bad experience, especially when the media portrays something bad, they usually, if the bad has been done by a non-white person, they always bring up their origin, and it had formed a fear of immigrants, and that's why they're not welcome, and that's why suffer those people who have lived their whole life in America, but just because they have a different color skin, they still being treated unfairly. And the idea of the melting pot took 180 really, because what once was a good idea and it wasn't evil at all, it was to bring everyone together to share like one wonderful world of beautiful diverse cultures, it just didn't work. And it's complete opposite now, because everyone is mistreating everyone, and people, they always bring up their cultural background if they want to insult you. People are being offensive, and people have those stigmas that have been formed for more than 50 or 70 years. And what we have now, I feel like, is still the remains of the fall of the melting pot ideology and the fail of the melting pot ideology.
I would like to start observing in-betweenness and cultural hybridity with presentation of some theoretical aspects. First of all, we have to admit the fact that language is influenced by ideology. Speaking about language, I mean any sign system. For instance, it can be language, images, clips, etc. This fact was revealed by Karl Marx, who claimed that cultural environment is shaped by dominant social class and serves its needs and interests. Later, this idea was developed by Michel Foucault, who remade it in the concept of discourse, meaning communicational field manifested in texts and influenced by ideology and power relationships in society. This concept is in great importance because discourse is the main tool of worldview formation. It functions as a framework through which person perceives society and defines power relationships, appropriate social practices, attitude towards various social groups, and so on. In discourse perspective, the concept of representation plays significant role as a tool of image creating and expressing ideas standing behind this or that sign or concept. Discourses and representation form texts, of which is a row of concepts and ideas implied by author and decoded by interpreter. A reflection of in-betweenness and hybridity also has its own patterns and codes of representation, which are shaped by discourses and manifested in various cultural texts from literature to advertisement. I would like to show them basing in particular examples of cultural artifacts devoting to the theme of hybridity and in-betweenness. Speaking about literature, I would like to choose Toni Morrison, one of the most prominent African-American writers. She made a huge contribution to uncovering problems of African-American community and formation of its identity. She was the voice of thousands of African Americans and inspired a lot of authors such as Angela Davis, Henry Damas, and many others. Her novel Song of Solomon is highly revealing in perspective of cultural hybridity. It narrates about young man Mac and Milkman Dad, who is trying to find his place in the world, his roots, and to understand his identity. As the plot develops, we see how he turns from selfish, detached from his family, African-American community, and the whole world boy, to a compassionate, remembering his roots man. In the novel, two characters are opposed to each other, Macken and Jita. Macken makes a journey in words into the past of his family and sees a complex mixture of Indian, African, American, Muslim cultures that coexist in his family. Jita is a member of 7 Days, organization which averages deaths of African Americans by killing white people. Their identities are in controversy and reflect two different ways of belonging to society. Macken is aware of its complexity and ambiguity, and for Jita it consists only of the opposition of himself and to white people and revenge. The next writer I want to talk about is Edwidge Dantica, an American of Haitian origin. As an example, I choose her story Book of Miracles, which narrates about a woman of Haitian origin, Anne,
who lives in New York City. She is in a crisis of self-determination because her husband belongs to a terrorist organization in Haiti, while she lives in peaceful community of Haitians in America, which is struggling to oppose to the organization. We see that members of the organization and residents of the community consider themselves Haitians and love their country, but their views and ways of struggle are completely different. Anne has to live in a lie, hiding from her neighbor that her husband belongs to the organization. On the one hand, she remains to the American principles of life, which are followed by community, and on the other hand, she sincerely loves her homeland and considers herself a Haitian, and her husband, who for this reason joined to the organization, has similar feelings. Anne feels herself a stranger among residents of the Haitian community in New York City, but she doesn't approve methods which have been chosen by her husband. She understands that she doesn't belong to the community completely and trying to mimic in order to survive, and due to it she is constantly pursued by feelings of loneliness, guilt and isolation. Further, I would like to consider movies and series to make complete analysis of phenomenon of in-betweenness and cultural hybridity, since books are more likely to belong to elite culture and are focused on adults, and movies are especially serious, are more oriented on youth and belong to mass culture. As an example of series, I choose the Norwegian series Skam or Shame, one of the seasons of which is dedicated to a Muslim girl, Sana, whose family has lived in Norway for a long time. She is committed to Arabic traditions, she is very religious, wears hijab and so on, and she falls in love with a young man who is also belongs to Arabic culture, but he doesn't believe in God. On this basis, the heroine experiences an crisis of identity. She is like heroine of the story mentioned above, feels excluded from both Muslim and European communities. She was sure about her identity, but the meeting with the Arabic boy who wasn't religious confused her. So we can see biases even inside hybrid communities. As the plot develops, we see how European and Muslim characters are biased towards each other. Obviously, the main problem is ignorance of each other's worldview and prejudice that the heroes don't try to dispel. At the end of the series, when Sana goes a long way to realization of herself, we see that all the environment of her has changed as well. People of different cultures get closer to each other, they become more tolerant, they are ready to learn more about the worldview of other people, and so on. We also see that Arabic and Muslim communities are very heterogeneous, which encourages viewers to the idea that it's impossible to create a single stereotype about the barriers of a particular culture or religion, and makes people to look at the world free from biases. In perspective on in-betweenness and cultural hybridity, the film This Is England seems very remarkable. A film is about the skinhead movement in England of 80s. As you know, this subculture is distinguished by ultra-right views, intolerance towards immigrants, racism, nationalism, and so on. However, in the gang, which is described in the film, there is a boy, Milky, whose family is from Jamaica, and the gang itself is shown in a quite harmless way. There is a fragment in the film when Milky talks about his family and his numerous relatives who came from Jamaica and brought local traditions with them, and he remembers them with love and tenderness, which speaks of his attachment to his native culture. But at the same time, he is one of the skinheads standing for the idea of Englishness. This example is very revealing because it shows the person chooses his or her identity and constructs own personality. Stereotypes, clichés, biases do not work when we deal with real people, as such thinking only leads to cruelty and violence, which is very well shown in the film. We see a different attitude towards Milky inside the gang. Some skinheads treat him as a friend and others hate him, although all they belong to the same subculture. This shows that our perception of people of other cultures depend on personal experience, stereotypes and ideas that ideology has formed, and they create a kind of blinders that prevent us from seeing people as they are and make us to perceive them as a set of learned stereotypes. I would like to finish with the most revealing manifestation of mass culture advertisement. It is always aimed to influence on unconscious of people and represents their associations with the certain concepts which should correlate among buyers with particular product. Using advertisement as an example, it is best to trace with the stereotypes about particular group of people are formed by members of society. I would like to look at the fashion industry and compare the advertisement of perfume of the lead brands and clothes of the most popular brand of mass production, H&M. Elite brands are aimed at wealthy adult people who value luxury, for whom power and status are very important. All these words are associated and embodied aristocracy of past time, so the images used in such an advertisement are usually very traditional. We see classically beautiful white women, confident, strong, powerful white men, and behind them usually there are ancient palaces, luxurious interiors, and so on. All the artifacts that show status and power are associated with white people and reminiscences to the past great eras. I found only one advertisement in which the main character was an African girl. Outwardly, all the classical attributes are preserved, but the behavior of the heroes of the advertisement creates a new motif of rebellious youth and freedom. This is exactly what we find in the advertisement of such mass-market brands as H&M. In almost all of the advertisement, we see people of different races, nationalities, ethnic groups who have fun together with each other and so on. We see stereotypes about cultural hybridity as something peculiar to young culture, something rebellious, something supposed to be a kind of a protest and opposed to the dominant paradigm of the world of adults. In-betweenness and cultural hybridity are excluded from that elite circle and are still used to convey kind of marginal phenomena that are in contrary with the mainstream paradigm. This shows that our society is still full of stereotypes, prejudices, and biases, and many people remain excluded from representation even in visual content. Thank you for attention.